Hello students, today we are going to discuss about Staphylococcus aureus. So before I start, we will talk about what is Staphylococcus. So Staphylococcus, I'll just break up the meaning of the name Staphylococcus. Staph means bunch or bunch of grapes, and coccus means that spherical shaped bacterium. So Staphylococcus means when bacteria of spherical shape are arranged in the form of grape-like clusters. So in Staphylococcus, we are going to study about Staphylococcus aureus, which is one of the most common pathogen. And under Staphylococcus aureus, we'll discuss its morphology, cultural characteristic, that means how it appears on different culture media. Its pathogenesis, how it causes diseases, and the laboratory diagnosis, that means how we'll collect the sample and diagnose or isolate the pathogen from the sample. Now, first we'll discuss about the morphology. As you can see a picture here, wherein I have put the diagram, the basic morphology of Staphylococcus. You can see this violet color, round spherical cocci here and there. Here you can see there are two cocci, then there is singles, and here you can see that many single cocci have clumped together in a cluster form, and this is what I was talking about. It's called Staphylococcus. So Staphylococcus belongs to the family Micrococcaceae, under which there are many other organisms also, but this is one of the very most common pathogen. Now this is a picture of gram staining. So in gram staining, Staphylococcus are gram positive cocci. Gram positive, you can see the color, by the color only you can tell it is violet in color, so it is gram positive, and it has the shape of coccus or cocci. So this is how Staphylococcus aureus looks under microscope when stained with gram stain. And Staphylococcus aureus is the most important pathogen of the genus Staphylococcus. There are certain organisms which are normally found in the body and are non-pathogenic, like Staphylococcus epidermidis or Staphylococcus saprophyticus. They all are called CONS. CONS stands for coagulase negative Staphylococcus. That means these organisms test negative when tested for coagulase test, and they all are under this group. So these are the two common examples, Staphylococcus epidermidis and Staphylococcus saprophyticus. Staphylococcus epidermidis is also a part of normal flora of the skin. Okay. Now coming to a little bit of introduction and morphology again about Staphylococcus aureus. So you can see Staphylococcus is an important human pathogen that causes a spectrum of clinical diseases. So that is another character of Staphylococcus aureus, that it is not confined to just one disease or only one type of diseases. So basically it can involve any organ of the body or any tissue of the body and start infection. Most common infections are associated with the superficial part of the skin, which is the skin. And what they do is, if there is a defective skin or rupture on the skin, this organism will go and colonize themselves in the area and start multiplying and secreting all the different enzymes or toxins, and they start the infection. So here you can see we have written deep-seated abscesses. Abscesses means these are the lesions in deep tissue where there is accumulation of pus. When I say pyogenic infection, this also refers to infection where there is pus formation. So Staphylococcus aureus is mostly associated with pyogenic infections or abscesses wherein there is a lot of pus formation. The pus that is formed during Staphylococcus aureus infection is very thick. The consistency is very thick, and it sometimes appears yellowish or slightly yellowish in color. Next is the morphology again. In the previous slide, we already saw the morphology, and here we have written clearly the gram-positive cocci, 1 micron in diameter. They are non-motile, non-sporing, non-capsulated. So these are the general features of the morphology of staphylococci aureus. So far, all you need to remember is the most common pathogen is Staphylococcus aureus from the genus Staphylococcus. Then the morphology is gram-positive cocci, non-motile, non-sporing. Now coming to the cultural characteristic. Before I start, let me tell you what are cultural characteristic. Cultural characteristic is a very important feature which helps us to identify an organism when we try to cultivate it or isolate it in the laboratory. So it basically means when you grow an organism on a culture plate or a media, how it appears, what is its features, and based on that we can make the identification. I'm not saying that just by looking at the plate and the growth you can tell this is the organism, but during identification procedure, step by step, this is also very helpful. So here I have taken nutrient agar. So this plate is nutrient agar, which is one of the basic medium or simple media, and you can see the colonies of Staphylococcus aureus. And if you see carefully, you can also see this golden yellow pigment. This is a very characteristic of Staphylococcus aureus. So they tend to produce this non-diffusible golden yellow pigment in the nutrient agar plate. You can see the colonies also, the isolated colonies. So they are not very small like Streptococcus. They are of pinhead size, and also you can see, always look for this pigment, okay? So this pigment is very characteristic of Staphylococcus aureus. You can see the measurement of the approximate measurement actually of the colonies. So they will be somewhere around 2 to 4 mm in diameter. And remember, the pigment that is produced is non-diffusible. If it's diffusible, the whole media will be taking up the color of the pigment. But you can see the color is only where the organism is present. So it's a non-diffusible pigment. So that was Staphylococcus aureus. How it grows on the nutrient agar plate. Next is very important, blood agar. Blood agar, we all know, is basically nutrient agar plus 5% sheep blood. So this is the plate of blood agar, and you can see the organism growing. Now if you go back, you look at the size of the colony here, and you go back to nutrient agar and look at the size. I know these are two different pictures taken from two different angles, so cannot actually compare, but here you can definitely make out the size of the colony. You can see the size of the colony here is smaller as compared to the size of the colony over here. It's bigger. Why it's bigger is because here blood is giving them extra nutrition. That's why they have better growth here. Now, what is important to look over here is the lysis or the hemolysis. So Staphylococcus aureus on blood agar produces beta hemolysis. You have a picture here where they have enlarged this portion, and you can see this is the colony, and around the colony there is some clear area. Okay, you compare this area and you compare the area where near the colony. So near the colony, these are slightly clear as compared to the rest of the plate. So this is called beta hemolysis. So wherever they are growing, due to production of certain toxins, they are causing the beta hemolysis. So on blood agar, Staphylococcus aureus shows beta hemolysis. And we always use sheep blood agar, and should not use human blood, because human blood will have inhibitors like antibiotics or antibodies that may not allow the organism to grow. So it should always be sheep blood agar. Okay, now let's see the cultural characteristic. So far we have seen cultural characteristic on solid medium. Nutrient agar was a solid medium. Blood agar is a solid medium. Now let's see how Staph aureus looks in a liquid medium. So this is a test tube with nutrient broth. You can see this turbidity over here. You can see this is not clear. Okay, so if it was nutrient broth with no growth, it will be very clear. You can see through the medium, but you can't see. You see the turbidity here, here, here. It looks like something is resolved there. Okay, so this is nothing but your Staphylococcus aureus, which is growing in the media. So over here, these are all the colonies of the organism. This is a very characteristic feature, and sometimes you will also see a raindrop appearance in the test tube. Since we have this typical cluster shape, so they appear as this big chunks of growth on the liquid medium. If it was some other bacteria, you will see a uniform turbidity, but here you don't see the uniform turbidity. You see the chunks over here, over here, over here, over here. So that is because of the morphology of the bacteria and how it is arranged. So this was its cultural characteristic on liquid medium. Coming to the pathogenesis. Before I start, we will talk about what actually pathogenesis is. Sometimes students are confused thinking that pathogenesis is what happens in the disease. That means fever, cough, cold. I'm not talking about staph aureus, but they think that they confuse themselves with the symptoms. So pathogenesis is not symptoms. Pathogenesis means when an organism enters your body, what is the mechanism it goes through or what it does that the symptoms appears. So what exactly the pathogen does to your cells or to your tissue that you see the symptoms. So that is pathogenesis, or you can say in simple terms, what all is done by the bacteria to start the disease. So under pathogenesis, let's talk about virulence factors. Now virulence factors, many of you may not know what these terms mean, so I will be quickly going through these terms also. So virulence factor is the factor that makes a bacteria pathogenic. So before, in the first few slides, we discussed that in under Staphylococcus genus, there are pathogenic also, which is Staphylococcus aureus, and then there are non-pathogenic Staphylococcus also. But what makes them pathogenic and non-pathogenic is this virulence factor. Presence of these virulence factors will make the organism pathogenic. So those organisms which have this virulence factor, which possess these factors, are pathogenic, and those who don't have it, they are non-pathogenic. So let's see what are the major virulence factors. So first is cell wall associated proteins and polymers. So there are certain proteins that are present in the cell wall of this bacteria, and as it enters human body or it colonizes in the human tissue, what happens is these proteins have an adverse effect, or they interfere with the healthy propagation of the cell. Next is extracellular enzymes. Extracellular enzymes means, so there are certain enzymes that are secreted by these bacteria, for example catalase, coagulase. So these enzymes, what it does is it helps the organism to start the disease. So all these factors, which are, these are normally found in the bacteria, but for us they can be harmful. Then toxin. Again, the bacteria produces certain toxin. One of the example is, let me come back to blood agar again. Why do you see hemolysis on blood agar? That's because bacteria produces a toxin called hemolysin, and that hemolysin breaks down the RBC. So that is one toxin. So likewise, there are many toxins that are produced by Staph aureus, and those cause the pathogenesis of the disease. Now, Staph aureus are pyogenic bacteria that cause localized lesions, in contrast to Streptococci. So Streptococci is another gram-positive organism that also causes pyogenic infection. I already made it very clear that pyogenic infections means infections that are that produce pus. So both Staphylococci and Streptococci are important organisms that causes pyogenic infections. But in Staph aureus, it is localized. That means the pus is not very runny. It has a very thick consistency. Whereas in streptococci, the pus is running. That is all what they are trying to mean by this line. Okay. So, basically what happens, staphylococci adhere to the damaged skin, mucosa or tissue surface. So, first thing what happens is, before all these things are secreted, all these virulence factors come in action, first thing is, whenever you have a damaged skin, this is very important, and I will give you an example to understand it. Patients with burn, okay, burned patients are very prone to get Staphylococcus aureus infection because their upper layer tissue or the skin is completely burned and their underlying tissues are exposed. So these organisms, what they do is they go and adhere, they stick to the damaged skin. Now I think it is more clear. So they go and stick to the damaged skin and then they start secreting all these factors like your cell wall associated protein or enzymes or toxins. And what happens, these things together start forming the pus and all that thing happens, and then you see the damage or the lesion of the disease. Okay. Now here I have taken some pictures from Google to show you how Staphylococcus aureus infection. Here you can see this is an infection wherein, you know, you can see the redness, and in the center if you see there is formation of the pus. Here also there is lesion, and this white area is indication of pus inside there. Here also there is pus formation. These two images, the last two images, is from burned patient. Now you can see a very large area of the skin is burned. You can see this is the leg of the patient, and the near the knee of the patient you have a very huge patch of burn. Okay, now this is very badly contaminated by the bacteria. You can see this white area, there is nothing but the pus formation. Like I said, burn patient tend to have their skin burned, completely burned, so it's all exposed for the bacteria to come and stick. Here also the upper layer of the skin is burnt, and that's why the bacteria managed to sit here and start the infection, and you can see that there is, you know, lot of pus here. So it becomes very important in burn patients especially to safeguard them from this bacteria, because they can propagate, they can multiply very faster and cause the disease. I hope these pictures make it easier for you to understand the pathogenesis. Okay, now coming to the laboratory diagnosis of a staphylococcal infection. So first thing, the laboratory diagnosis is what specimen we will collect. Okay, now we cannot say one particular specimen, because like I said in the first few slides, this bacteria can infect multiple organs or tissues. It can cause infection or abscess in the deep tissue. So wherever the site is, you have to collect the specimen from there only. Specimen to be collected for demonstration of staphylococci depends on the nature of the lesion. So if it's on the superficial part of your body, you have to take it or swab it. That I would suggest, you have to swab the pus sample very carefully without contaminating it with the rest of the skin. If it's a deep tissue abscess, you have, with the help of a syringe, it should be aspirated and sent to the laboratory. So depending on the condition, in the books we will see collect the pus or wound swab, just like that. But yeah, that's textbooks. But when you work in the lab, it's not the same. So like you always have to look at the type of lesion, where it is located, which part of the body, and accordingly plan how you are going to collect the sample. That is more practical thing to do. Okay, so once you have collected the sample, the first thing we do is the microscopy. Microscopy means first we have to see what is there in the sample before we go ahead and do culture or anything else. you need to know what is there in the sample, what exactly is present, and only when you know what is there in the sample, based on that only you can plan how you are going to go about the culture. After collecting specimen, if you directly jump on culture, that is very bad, because you are doing everything blindly. You have no clue what you are dealing with, what you are handling. So it should always go step by step. Once you collect the specimen, the first thing you can do is direct microscopy. Direct microscopy is not just microscopy that can give you an idea what is present in the sample, but also it is very helpful for the physician who is treating the patient. It gives the physician an idea what exactly is the causative organism, and they can start the preliminary treatment. That's very important, because in case of microbiology, your culture takes time. So depending on microscopy of the specimen or direct microscopy, the physician can get a lot of help from your side and start the treatment. That's very important. So be very careful when you are doing a direct microscopy. Can be affected by wrong sampling, so please do the sampling properly without contaminating the sample. Okay, so when we do direct microscopy, so the most common stain that we use for direct microscopy is gram stain, and under gram staining, I have already told you, you'll see gram positive cocci arranged in cluster. You'll also see pus cells. Okay, pus cells that will appear color. So this is what you are going to see in gram staining, if at all Staphylococcus aureus is present. Then you are going to do culture. Identify the organism based on the cultural characteristic and biochemical test. For that, you have to grow the organism. So you have to culture it on preferred medias like nutrient agar or blood agar, and then you have to incubate the plates in 37 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. Okay, so once you do this, you culture it. So coming back to, yeah. So like I said, you can use nutrient agar. So this is how it will look like. The organism will grow like this. And on your blood agar, this is what is expected if it is Staphylococcus aureus. So you are expected to see beta hemolysis. Now, after that, what do you do? You have done specimen collection, you have done direct microscopy, you did culture, and on the plates, you have the growth now. Now, next what? Next, you have to do biochemical tests. So, in biochemical tests, the most important ones are catalase test. Now, catalase test is a test wherein we look for the enzyme catalase. We see whether the organism produces this enzyme or not. Okay, this is also a test which differentiates between Staphylococcus and Streptococcus. So here what we do is, you can see this picture over here, the first picture. Here we have two slides. In both the slides, we have taken hydrogen peroxide. This is just a representation of positive and negative. Hydrogen peroxide is the catalyst reagent. And what you do is, you take your test organism, pick it up with a wooden stick from the nutrient agar plate, and just mix it with the hydrogen peroxide. If catalase is present, you will see this kind of bubbles, which means it is positive. If it is not present, there will not be formation of any bubbles, which you can see under this negative slide. So that is catalase test, and catalase test is positive for Staphylococcus aureus. So that's what you are supposed to see. Next is coagulase test. Coagulase test is very important. It differentiates Staphylococcus aureus from rest of the Staphylococcus. So coagulase test can be done either by slide method or by tube method. I put both the pictures over here. So basically what happens is, again, coagulase is also an enzyme, and we check for its presence or absence by doing coagulase test. Now what this coagulase enzyme does is, we use plasma in this test. So basically, plasma has soluble fibrinogen, and this coagulase enzyme converts this soluble fibrinogen into insoluble fibrin clot. So when we bring this bacterial suspension in contact with the plasma, if coagulase is produced, you will see this kind of clumps. Because of the formation of fibrin clot, you will see this clumps. If it is negative, it will remain like this. If you are doing tube method, negative will be like this. And here you can see a positive tube test, wherein you know the plasma has been clotted by the action of coagulase enzyme. So these are two preliminary and very important biochemical tests that should be positive when you are doing a identification of Staphylococcus aureus. And never play with the chronology of this test. Catalase should always come first, and after that only you can do coagulase. It will not make any sense doing catalase after you have done coagulase. So always do catalase and then you come for coagulase. Okay, so that was the laboratory diagnosis of Staphylococcus aureus. Now you can, one possibility that I want to tell you, if catalase is positive but coagulase is negative, so what will be the result that you are supposed to get? If catalase is positive, that means the genus is confirmed, it is Staphylococcus. Coagulase, if it is negative, that means it is cons. In the first slide, we had discussed about cons. Yeah, here. So any other important human pathogen are coagulase negative, staphylococci. So if coagulase comes negative, they are still staphylococci. They are called coagulase negative staphylococcus. So that's how you have to report if the coagulase comes negative. Okay. Now, very important thing that is nowadays very much in the news, or you as a microbiology student must know, is methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. So earlier in your textbook and all, for Staphylococcus, it's only Staphylococcus, that's more than enough to know. But I suggest you also should know what is methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA. So MRSA is a resistant strain of Staphylococcus. These are also Staphylococcus only, but those Staphylococcus which are resistant to methicillin or penicillin group of antibiotics are grouped into this category called methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. So that was methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus. Now let me tell you, how do bacteria become resistant to antibiotics? What is antibiotic resistant? You people must have heard multiple times that bacteria is resistant, or in the drug is not working on the patient because the patient, the bacteria has become drug resistant or antibiotic resistant. So let me tell you one scenario that I'm sure all of us must have faced. We suffer from something. We have an infection and we go to the doctor. The doctor give us antibiotics for 7 days, or let's just say 5 days. We come back, we take the medicine. First day we have taken medicine. Second day we take the medicine, we feel better. Third day even better. And by third day we think that, okay, now I feel very good. And the antibiotic or the medicine has done what it was supposed to do. I don't think I should take it anymore. Many of us think that it may damage our liver. Okay. But there is a reason why the physician has given you an antibiotic course of 5 days. But what we do is, 3 days we have taken the medication and we feel very good, and we discontinue the antibiotics. Now what happens? What happens inside your body? Why do you feel good with only 3 tablets when you are asked to take 5 tablets? Well, you have the bacteria inside your body that was causing the manifestation, and when you started taking the antibiotics, definitely it went there and it reduces the numbers of bacteria. Suppose you had 1,000 bacteria inside your gut that was causing the uncomfort, and when you took the antibiotic, 1,000 became say 800 in the first day, then it became 700 the second day, it became 600 the third day, and if the number of bacteria that was causing you problem was reduced, definitely you'll feel better. But there's still some bacteria there. Thousands of them are not cleared from the gut. There's still some bacteria there, and you are no longer taking your antibiotics. Now those which have survived, they know that there was this medicine which was coming, and how it was working, how it killed our friends. Now they have understood how this antibiotic has worked, and what they are going to do is they are going to design their daughter cells or their offspring in such a way that they are not affected by this particular mechanism of action of antibiotic. So you see, the next generation of bacteria which are developed will be mutated ones. And again, if these bacteria increases, you'll again run to the doctor and tell the doctor, and the doctor will again give you, looking at the symptoms, same symptoms, will give you the same medication. Now you are popping in the tablets, but nothing has happened. Why? Because now there is a generation which is mutated and which is resistant to this antibiotic. This antibiotic is no longer going to work, because these bacteria are produced or designed in such a way by their parents or their mother cells that the mechanism of action is not going to work. In case of methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus or MRSA, something like that happens. So there is a gene called MECA gene. Okay, so normally this MECA gene is not found in normal Staphylococcus aureus. So in the resistant ones or the MRSAs, you will find this gene. Now what this gene does is, when penicillin, normally when penicillin or methicillin is taken, it goes and binds to the bacteria through a protein that is present in the surface of the bacteria called penicillin binding protein. So the drug goes and binds to this protein and then get attached to the bacteria and starts its mechanism of action and kills the bacteria. That is what normally happens. But in this MRSA, what this gene does is it changes the structure of the protein binding, penicillin binding protein. So normal PBP is now converted to PBP2A. Now this penicillin which we are taking does only recognizes the normal protein, penicillin binding protein. But the new one is, which is developed by this gene, is penicillin binding protein 2, which is not recognized by penicillin antibiotics, and thus the penicillin is not going to bind with the organism, and even if you take penicillin, it is not going to help reduce or kill the organism. So that's how methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus are resistant, and they start to continue to infect the patient. It's very important to wash your hands in case of MRSA. It's a very major pathogen that is, the cause of hospital acquired infections also. So proper hand washing, screening of medical staff is very important if you want to, handle the spread of MRSA. And especially for burn patient, this can be a very deadly organism. So proper surveillance should be there in the hospitals to prevent the spread of this organism. So that is all about Staphylococcus aureus. If you have any questions, you can always ask in the comment box. Thank you so much.